Welcome to Electrified. It's your host, Dylan Loomis. Happy Wednesday. And a quick shout out to my newest patrons, Norm, Bernard, Tim, and George. Thank you guys for the support. And just real quick, look what arrived. We are awaiting on one final gift, and then it will be time. But seriously, guys, thank you all very, very much. First up today, it looks like Alaska is getting its own EV charging network, as right now the EV charging is few and far in between. And yes, there are not that many EVs in the area, but it is growing. And the Alaska Energy Authority plans to install DC fast charging stations along the state's main highway corridor. The AEA has about $1 million in funds from the VW Dieselgate scandal, but they're also looking for contributions from private businesses as well. And this plan is calling for 9 stations to be less than 100 miles apart. And sticking with charging infrastructure, some pretty cool news here, as now power or utility companies are teaming up to build out their own EV charging networks across the country. Over 50 utilities have come together to speed up the build out of EV charging. The new council will be known as the National Electric Highway Coalition. This is an association of investor-owned power companies. So these companies are gonna look to fill charging infrastructure gaps along major travel corridors, and they're expected to act in good faith and to use any approach they see fit, and to do so by the end of 2023. As of now, there are about 1.8 million EVs registered in the United States that can only use around 46,000 public charging stations. And of that available number at the moment, only 5,600 of those are set to be DC fast charging stations. And look, this stuff is great, but I personally would like to see the same push for at-home charging. So apartments and complexes where people don't have access to at-home charging, I would like to see things built out in that setting, because that's such a huge part of the ease of owning an EV, is being able to just come home, plug in, and not worry about it at all. Neo in Australia tweeted out, "The Victorian big battery is up and running in time for summer." Of course, Tesla played a big role in this, as they have supplied 212 megapacks for the project. And this project is expected to save Victorians over $220 million over the next decade. And if you'd like to get into the weeds on this one, I will include a link to this website below. It's just app.electricitymap.org, but you can check out different locations and get a almost real-time view of the electricity use and where it's coming from. So if you hover over Victoria, you can see 42% of its energy is coming from low carbon and renewable sources, with even more detail given over on the left, once again linked below. Just real quick, in case you were looking, Tesla was offering the 21-inch Uber turbine wheel and winter tire package for $4,750. The item is out of stock already. Plenty of people were looking for a tire of this size for the winter, so hopefully they get this back in stock soon. But these are Pirelli Soto Zero 3 tires. So here we have a European registration document covering some expected changes for the Model 3 and Y. Now, presumably some of these will already be implemented in the vehicles coming from Giga Shanghai that are being exported to Europe, and some may be changes that are going to be coming specifically from Giga Berlin built models. So I'll go ahead and leave this up so you can take a screenshot and read through all of them if you would like, but there's one I want to point out that's getting a lot of questions: adding interior cabin radar for the Model Y. Now, of course, Tesla has the interior camera for driver monitoring, but what is this additional radar for the interior going to be? Well, there's a couple of things. Cabin sensing combines camera data with radar sensors and intelligent algorithms to cover the entire vehicle interior. It will also help to recognize children, but not just humans, but also pets, dogs, etc. as well. With real-time object monitoring of the entire vehicle interior, Continental is going beyond purely driver monitoring and offering an additional building block for future mobility models, such as automated or autonomous driving. But here's the heart of the matter: the technology meets future safety regulations of the European Commission and the Euro NCAP. So the thought here is that with this new cabin sensing solution, it will meet the new requirements of the EU General Safety Regulation, or the GSR, and also help automobile manufacturers to score well in the Euro NCAP. So this interior cabin radar will of course add more functionality for monitoring the inside of the vehicle, which yes, people will have objections to, but when it comes to regulations, specifically when we get to autonomy, this is going to be a big deal and a way for Tesla to future-proof their vehicles for these regulations, specifically right now in the European market. And I will link this article below if you'd like to check it out. So here we have it, Tesla's sales data for November out of Shanghai. Now, a lot of people out there are somewhat panicking, a little worried about the numbers, so I really want to add some perspective to the conversation. So Tesla sold 52,859 vehicles in November. Here is the breakdown of the export, domestic, and wholesale. So let's take a look at the chart to get some perspective. Here are the numbers for November plugged in, and it's color-coded so you can compare each month of the respective quarter. So November is a white row, which means it's the second month of the quarter, so it would be good to compare to August, which the numbers are right here. So the domestic sales, of course, would be much improved. However, the exports here are really the weak part of this report, and as you can see, 52,800 is lower than both September and October when you look at the total wholesale numbers from China. So first of all, just a reminder, nothing in this world goes straight up monotonically, okay? You're gonna have some ups and downs, even for a hyper-growth company like Tesla. So we cannot expect every month here in this column to just go higher and higher and higher and higher and higher. That's not how it works, okay? So fluctuations are normal. But the truth is, these numbers are just okay, you know? Especially when you consider that in October, when they did 54,300, they were basically shut down for the first week of October due to holiday. So many people were expecting this number for November to be closer to 60,000, you know, somewhere between 57 and 60,000. And of course, Tesla has fallen fairly short of that estimate. And reminder too, that even the best of the best in the Tesla community that do these projections and estimates each quarter, they're going to get it wrong sometimes because we don't have all of the information. We're just going off of whatever is available publicly, and there's so much behind the scenes that we're just not aware of. But let's add some more context here. So NIO sold 10.8 thousand cars last month, XPeng sold 15,600, and Volkswagen sold over 14,000 of their ID series in China in November. So Tesla still significantly ahead of this data set. But even more important than that is looking at the overall passenger car sales in November in China, which totaled 1.85 million, which was down 12.5% from 1 year ago. So the overall passenger car sales market is down pretty significantly from last year, something we need to just keep in mind with looking at these numbers. And just another thing to consider, we have the Evergrande situation still very much ongoing, basically on the brink of defaulting on its debt that could cause a cascading throughout the entire economy. They have $300 billion of liabilities. They were one of the biggest property developers in China, and this has caused a lot of uncertainty even for the US markets. So you have to remember that this has an overhang of sorts on the Chinese market. It's gonna affect stocks and liquidity and fear in the market, which could lead people to, you know, not want to buy a vehicle at that time. And another point, I think some people have already forgotten what Elon just said about the end of quarter delivery push and trying to smooth out that wave by not spending so much extra money to expedite these end of quarter pushes and just to slow it down and to do it as efficiently as possible because they don't have to play the game as much. And so maybe to some degree, we're starting to see this decision play out in these November numbers that are a little deflated from what people were expecting. And I know this last point seems like a cop-out and an excuse, but these supply challenges are real, and in my opinion, I don't think they're going away anytime in the next few months. So we're just gonna have some level of uncertainty and unknowns in the market, especially when you add on fears with the ongoing pandemic and all these other things. The point here is that 1 month of sales figures being down from what the community was expecting is not a big deal in the grand scheme of things. Now, if this were to be a downturn over the next 6 months where we get numbers in the 50,000s, 40,000s, 30,000s, then we can start talking about a problem or an issue, but there's just so much focus on the short-term data and minutia because we all love following Tesla so much that I think too many people are losing perspective. Just zoom out and look at the macro numbers, okay? In the not too distant future, we're gonna have four factories producing anywhere from 400,000 to 800,000 units per year. So do not sweat these 1 month numbers. Don't worry about it. Yes, they weren't great. They were lower than what we were expected, but I'm telling you right now, it's going to be okay. Okay, let's move on. So Car and Driver tested the Model S Plaid, saying it is the quickest charging EV they have tested. Real quick, they tested from 10 to 90% state of charge, and it hung out at the peak charging rate for almost 5 minutes before tapering off. The total time to charge from 10 to 90% was 38 minutes. But what they're getting at is the Plaid had the highest average charging rate over the duration of the charge, which they averaged out to 125 kilowatts. That betters the average charging rate than competitors like the Audi e-tron at 121, Porsche Taycan at 118, and some of the other competition wasn't even close, like the ID4 that averaged 82 and the Mach-E that averaged 47. Raj was saying how he loves entertaining his kids in the car while waiting for takeout food and that it's so underrated. Elon said, a lot of people don't realize that you can watch almost any show in a Tesla. So if that was you, now you know. Mo on Twitter shared a post from Max Tuzes Hobson on what Tesla has learned from the trials of the Model 3 as a police car. So I'll throw this up on the screen and you can pause it and read it as you would like to. But in case you're not familiar, Max Tuzes Hobson is the account manager and emergency services lead at Tesla. And two points I'd like to highlight that I thought were really cool. They said the light bars are like running with a parachute. Integrating the lights into the car cabin doesn't affect drag kill efficiency and requires no holes to be drilled into the roof, which also has a negative effect on the car's residual values. And more of an intangible impact, but the public response to seeing our active units has been mind-blowing. The press articles have been positive as well. As an engagement tool, we're seeing incredible results. Tesla gets a new high watermark for a price target of $1,580 from Pierre Farragut from New Street Research. He of course cited strong delivery numbers and also that the focus next year will be on 4680 battery cells, and he's expecting it to be up in full swing and growing by the end of 2022. And here we have an interesting item. The Renault Zoe loses all stars in the latest Euro NCAP road safety ranking, which we just talked about earlier in the episode. The NCAP said Renault was once synonymous with safety, but these disappointing results for the Zoe show that safety has become a collateral victim of the group's transition to electric cars. A Renault spokesperson added that with a tightening of the NCAP standards every 2 years, the same vehicle could not automatically obtain the same marks between its launch and its end of life. And this is important to watch because in the first 10 months of the year, the Zoe was the third best-selling electric car in Europe, behind only the Model 3 and the ID3. And I will leave you guys with some new footage from Jay in Shanghai. But that is all for today. Please take a second to like the video if you did. Hope you all have a wonderful day, and a huge thank you to all of my Patreon supporters.